Hi guys, glad you could make it onto the webinar today. My name's Jessica and I'm the PR director here at Postcard Mania. I'm today's webinar organizer, so I'll be helping out behind the scenes and Joy Jindusa is your presenter. I wanna go over just a few housekeeping things before we can begin. So if you cannot hear me or if you don't see Joy's first slide that says how to market your business everywhere locally and outrank competitors, if you can't see that, if you just see a black screen, then let me know with a quick chat comment in the chat section of the control panel. And just for future reference, don't be shy. If you have a question as Joy presents and goes along, just type it in and send it in the questions panel. I'll either answer your question as we go or I'll save it for later for Joy. We will get to your question at the end, so just sit tight. All right, so it looks like you all can hear me okay. And I can see Joy's screen. Everything looks good. It looks like we're ready to get started. Your presenter today is Joy Jindusa. Joy is the founder and CEO of Postcard Mania, a marketing company that specializes in lead generation. Joy grew her business from a small startup in 1998 with only a phone, a computer, and postcard marketing. That means no capital injections or financial backing of any kind. And today, Joy has taken that small startup and turned it into an industry leader. Postcard Mania employs 236 people and generates over $49 million in annual revenue. Her marketing strategies and accomplishments are regularly featured in top publications such as Entrepreneur, Business Insider, Inc. Magazine, and more. So here's your presenter today, Joy Jindusa.
Hi, everybody. Thank you very much for attending. I'm always excited about people that want to learn more about marketing because honestly, if anyone is to ask me, like, how was I able to grow my business organically without any investors from nothing to what it is today, it's because I market more than any sane person would think is appropriate, to be honest. And it honestly takes that much energy and effort in your marketing to really make an impact and to really get in the influx of business that you desire. And I want to show you some things that you can implement right away in your business and help you. So I just get excited when you guys want to learn. So thank you for coming. I'll tell you a little bit about me, just so you know a little bit about who I am. Let's see, how come it's not doing this? Okay, here we go. That's me. I'm the girl. Well, I'm the obvious girl in the picture. Two of the dogs are also women. The Coco Brown dog there is Conan O'Brien with his red bone. The other fluffy dog is Tori Birch. The little white dog in my lap is Lulu Jindusa. I'm sitting next to my husband, Sam, and those are my two grown children behind me, James and Zach, both of whom I'm lucky enough to say work here at Postcard Mania. Zach is a marketing consultant here, and James did all the videos on Postcard Mania's website. That's my fam. That was like our Christmas card a few years ago. They're a little bit older, but they haven't changed yet. The dogs look the same too. Okay, so just a little bit about Postcard Mania. You could see on the left side, it's a terrible picture of me, and I hate you, Jessica, for using it in my PowerPoint every time because it's so ugly. But that's me when I first started Postcard Mania in 1998. That was the first trade show that I ever did. It's kind of like a homemade, homegrown booth. And on the right, that's fairly recently. We've moved into this building in 2009. We built it from the ground up. We have 227 employees now. And I'm just getting a hair clip, sorry. So I did this and I did it, you know, really using marketing. I would say the two people ask me all the time, how did you do this? How did you do this? It's marketing like a crazy person, like a lot, and realizing that consistency and quantity of communication put out is going to trump any tracking. It's going to trump anything. It's like quantity trumps everything. So I kind of knew that and went for that, but it's also surrounding myself with an amazing staff. I have incredible people working here, and I could never take all the credit for this at all, you know, including Jessica, who introduced me. She's wonderful, even though she uses that photo. Next, what you're going to learn today is these great things that I think you were promoted to about what you were going to learn. You're going to learn that the number one factor behind campaigns that generate returns on investment of huge amounts. So you're going to find out what that is. You're going to find out how to integrate Google Ads and Facebook actually into your marketing. Oh yeah, and that was the last thing on the bullet point. Now, everybody here, I'm sure, who's listening has had the situation where you've spent money on marketing and you didn't get the return that you expected. And that is not cool. I hate that. I hate when it happens to me. But one thing about me that's different, honestly, than most small business owners is that when that happens, I do not let it rule my future and it doesn't stop me from doing marketing. I figure out, sometimes even I will have like the best idea in the world. I'm like, oh my God, if we do this, it's going to be amazing. And we're going to try this. Oh, like I'll give you an example. I did radio for the summer. Sometimes I listen to talk radio and I hear these great commercials and I'm like, we have a great product. We have a great service. Let's try radio. I invested $53,000 into radio for a 3-month campaign. I'm not even sure if it's over yet. It was a spring into summer campaign and it bombed. I thought it was going to be amazing. It completely bombed. I threw away my money. I threw away $53,000. You know what? Easy come, easy go. I'm sorry. I'm not going to get freaky crazy about the loss. I tried it. I'll stick with my tried and true methods, which I'm going to share with you today. Only my tried and true. I would never share with you something and tell you to do it if it didn't work for me personally. So, you know, today you have a lot of competition. Everybody can go online. It's kind of crazy. So there's a lot. People are bombarded, crazy, crazy bombarded with marketing messages. And if you take just a little bit of effort, if you implement some of the things I'm going to teach you today, you will outmarket your competitors. You will be, they're not doing a great job. Your competitors are not doing a great job. So I want you to dominate your competitors. And how you do that, first and foremost, this is a really good thing to do. Sign up for all your competitors, sign up for their email. Like go to their website and put in your Gmail email address and get on their mailing list and sign up for their promotions, because you want to make sure that you know what your competitors are doing at all times, because then you can just do it better. The next thing is I want you to blind shop them. I don't really care if you take it all the way to the end where you actually purchase something. I do that all the time, by the way. I blind shop my competitors. And you want to see, you know, what are they doing better than you possibly, or get your confidence up because they're not doing it as good as you. And anything that they're doing, even in the beginning phases that are, you know, considered customer service, but really it's marketing because they're still making that impression on you. Anything that they're doing that you don't like, you're like, wow, we shouldn't do that. Sometimes you're not aware of the first impression you're making until you blind shop a competitor. And then suddenly you're real, real aware of whatever your first impression is. You can also have your own company blind shopped by a friend. There are professionals that do it. I would never pay the money. Just find somebody to do it that's a friend that will give them a checklist of things to ask and questions and get their feedback and have them type up a report for you so that you can always improve that first impression with your company. The next thing is to go to the website of all of your competitors, write a list of things that you like about their website and things that you hate about their website, and then go to your website and do the same. And that's going to give you a bunch of great ideas of how to be better than your competition. The next thing is a really cool thing you can do. Have you ever heard of Google Alerts? A Google Alert is like you can sign up for any search term or any name, and every time that search term or that name is on Google, it will give you an email and it'll tell you. So you can put in a Google alert for the names of all your competitors so that if they make any changes to their website, if they get any press, then you're on top of it and you see it. So that's what I want you to do in terms of just getting on top of your competition. And I'll show you something else that's pretty interesting. We have one of the ways that we bring in leads is with something we call Campaign Planner. And it's on our website and it's on a lot of our landing pages. And it starts out asking just for an email address, and then as you hit next and you hit next, it asks all kinds of questions. And one of the questions that we ask is, and this is just the results from 18,396 of our leads. We haven't updated this recently, but we ask them, what type of marketing are you doing, and why is this significant? So if you look at the results on this, you'll see that, yeah, it makes sense that 31% of the people are doing direct mail because we're a direct mail company and they're looking for direct mail, so they've probably done direct mail. But if you look at the one in bright orange, 43.5% of the people who we survey, they don't answer. Why don't they answer? they don't answer because they're not doing any marketing. So a lot of your competitors are not really doing any marketing, and to be better than them and out-market them is not as hard as it seems. Now, I'm going to tell you also as we go forward some of my story and some of the things that I've done, because when I show you that, that's my learning ground, has been my own company. I started this company, you know, I had a little agency, I had a couple of staff, and then I got this bright idea to do postcards. It's kind of a longer story than that, but I don't want to spend time on stuff that isn't teaching. But a lot of what I know comes from trial and error. So I'm going to show you some of my marketing. So this was my very first postcard that I designed, that I mailed to random. I actually bought a CD from Office Depot of the phone book. And hopefully some of you are close enough to my age that you remember those things. And I just targeted all businesses on the main drags of my town where I live, and here in Clearwater, Florida. We have State Road 60 and we have US 19. And I just targeted all the businesses. I didn't know who would respond. I didn't have any idea. And we were really the first postcard marketing company out there. There weren't any postcard marketing companies that were like selling to general businesses. So I started doing 1,000 pieces per week. Once I conceived of Postcard Mania in June of 1998, and we did just have our 20-year party, our 20-year anniversary party, I did 1,000 pieces a week to start. And I upped that eventually to 2,500 pieces per week. Now, it says on the slide, and then I jumped to 5,000 pieces per week, but that was no easy feat. What happened was, at 2,500 pieces a week, we started to plateau. We were, you know, with 1,000 pieces, I was getting business, and then I upped it a little bit, and I was getting more business. And at 2,500 pieces a week, we really hit a plateau where it felt, for me as a business owner, it felt like I was taking, you know, three steps forward, two steps back, two steps forward, three steps back. I mean, it was a little bit, I don't know if you've ever experienced that, but it's not fun. It takes the fun out of owning your own business. And, you know, I decided at that point that I was going to double the number of pieces I was sending out. And it was scary because at that time, 5,000 pieces was about $800 in postage, which is like nothing. I mean, it's gone way up, of course, in 20 years. But it was about $800 in postage. And ladies and gentlemen, that's what my salary was. I was paying myself $800 a week. And that was a lot of money, and I was kind of freaked out about it. But I decided I was going to do it, and I was going to do it for 6 weeks, and I was going to see what the results were after. Because, you know, just to back up for 1 second, direct mail postcard marketing is not one of those spontaneous purchases. It's like you think about it, you think you want to do it, you know you should be consistent, you want to get pricing, you go somewhere else to look for pricing. I mean, it's not like a spontaneous purchase. So I know that if I'm going to start mailing, that the people that I mail on week one, they may not even decide to contact me until week four. Because depending on the type of product or service you sell, that's kind of where, how you can gauge how long the sales cycle is. Sure, we have plenty of people that call us on the phone and pay right on the phone. You know, they want to get started. But I would say most people, it's like going to be within the 4 to 6 week period. So I did it. I took the plunge. I did the 5,000 pieces a week. And what I'm going to tell you next, I mean, this is true. This is not an exaggeration at all. In week five, my numbers doubled. I was averaging around $20,000 a week in revenue at the 2,500 pieces per week. And I doubled to 40, I think it was like 46,000 or something like that. And then we hit 50. And I was like, OMG, this works. This is crazy. The more I mail, the more money I make. Crazy. So it was, you know, now today, yes, we're doing 180,000 pieces a week. And you would think like, oh, 20, you'd think I'd be up to 1 million pieces a week in 20 years. But what happens is I have to juggle the number of pieces I mail out with the number of marketing consultants I have. I don't want them just helping the low-hanging fruit, so to speak, you know, the person who calls up and goes, all right, I'm ready to get started. This is my budget. These are the zip codes I want to hit. And if I sent out more cards, all my sales would be lay down sales where people have already closed themselves. And I want these guys to consult people and really help them make the right decision with their marketing. So that's my story. And here, I'll just show you a graph. This is actually the green line is our revenue line, and the pink line is our marketing spend. So you can see how they correlate. Crazy, crazy, crazy. Now, if you notice, the last line is 2018. So I'm showing you here, 2018. Obviously, we're only here. We're only here in 2018, right? But we're about 20% up over last year. And but we're not spending as much more on our marketing. And last year we did a test where we actually did some things to get more leads for less money. And that's what I'm going to be sharing with you today. So I'll get there. But it was the first time in our history that I was able to decrease the amount I spent on marketing and still increase my number of leads. So I'm excited to talk to you about that. But one of the very first things that I brought up was how consistent we are. In the 20 years now that I've been doing this, we have never, ever, ever, ever missed a single week of getting the mail out. Never. So when somebody says, well, I tried postcards, I did try to market, it really didn't work for us, I guarantee you there was an uptick somewhere. There were some sales made. Maybe you couldn't track it back exactly to the exact thing. But when you put that much communication out, you will get influx of business. I can say that without any doubt at all. I'll show you another graph. This is one of our clients who I love to pieces, Lakewood College. They're an online college. And the pink line you see is online registrations, and the green line is the number of postcards that they were mailing. So you can see the green line is flat. There's zero. This is 2011, January, February, March, April, May. And they're getting some registrations, but they have that, you know, very low numbers and also very, you know, like it's just a plateau. So they start mailing. They used to do their own postcards, and then they just get busy and they can't do it themselves. So they start doing it and they're basically listening to me, and I'm just like, keep increasing the numbers, keep increasing the numbers. You'll see an increase in the registrations. And they did. So they kept increasing and they kept increasing. And then they went, we got this. We don't need to do it next month. We'll take a month off from marketing, boom, nothing. And you see the numbers start to go down. Oh, quick, we better market. But a consistent amount. And then they didn't the next month. And then they did. And then they didn't. And they just started to decrease in their registrations. We got them back on consistent, consistent, consistent month after month mailing. And you can see what happened to the registrations. I can show you another one of my clients. I also love this guy. This is Patuxent Dental, and this is my friend Ahmed Khanna, Dr. Khanna, and he bought this practice. I believe he bought this practice. I think he bought it in 2007, and this is how they advertise: yard signs and yellow page ads. And he bought this practice, and he just watched the numbers go down, and then he started doing 6,000 pieces a month sometime in 2009. And he was consistently every single month doing 6,000 pieces, and you could see his numbers went up. And then he changed to 12,000 pieces and his numbers just started to go up. And then he added something called Direct Mail 2.0. And we call it Everywhere Small Business now. And I'll go over that with you later. But that's when his numbers went crazy exponential. He just built his own new building. He's got like three or four doctors working for him. And I just love it. I love when somebody does what I tell them to do and then they win. It makes me so super happy. So let's go over what like your job is as a marketer, because it's changed quite a bit over the last years. So your job as a marketer is to generate a lead. And whether you do that using postcards or Google or billboards or whatever you do, your job first and foremost is to generate a lead, to get somebody who is interested, somebody who's raised their hand somehow and said, I'm interested in what you have. But it's not enough just to get the person to be interested. You have to actually capture their identity. You need to know who they are so that you can follow up with them and then eventually close the sale. So we help with the first three: lead generation, lead capture, and follow up. But closing the sale, that's on you, of course. So we're going to go over lead generation. And you know, I just want to put us all on the same page with what is a lead, okay? So a lead, as I said, is anyone who sees your advertisement and they have some slight interest. And I'll talk to you about capturing their identity in a bit, but I don't even know if I go over that in detail on this webinar, because you know, none of us really like to fill out online forms. So there's a lot of technique that goes into doing that successfully. And if you're super interested in having like 2 full days of me talking to you about marketing a lot of practical assignments and learning, like really learning, I do have, I hope it's not sold out, but I do have a Small Business Growth Summit coming up September 20th and 21st. The 19th in the evening is the cocktail party, and then it's all day, the 20th and the 21st. But I'll tell you more about that later. All right, so we're going to talk about direct mail, because obviously this is direct mail, right? Let's talk about that first. First, hopefully those of you that are on the call, you don't need to be sold on that direct mail works, but I'll just give you some numbers to help you out a bit. If you compare direct mail to email in terms of targeting brand new people, direct mail does 607% better at getting new business and new leads than email does. Let me explain to you why. Why do you think email is not good for lead generation? Because email is an invasion. It's not only an invasion of your inbox, from like, if you get an email from some business and you didn't give them your email address, I know I feel like, who the F are you? Sorry, who are you and why are you emailing me? I don't want you to email me, especially because I'm working right now and I'm doing my emails. So I'm just doing delete, 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 because I'm not interested. So percentage wise, direct mail does better. Why? Because when you go to your mailbox, you as a consumer, and of course everybody you're targeting, that's the moment you are ready to receive the communication that's in the mailbox when you decide. So it's a much more palatable way to be communicated with advertising is with direct mail, because at that moment that you're looking at the mail, you're interested in looking at the mail. I'm sure you understand what I'm talking about. If you compare it to all other forms of marketing, like billboards, radio, pay-per-click, all kinds of direct mail wins over all other marketing. I love it. I love direct mail. That's why I'm in this business. So I'll give you some more stats. 54% direct mail is the most preferred form of marketing by customers. 67% of direct mail is looked at by recipients, believe it or not. This is all from InfoTrends and Marketing Sherpa, mostly InfoTrends. 40% of consumers have made a purchase in the last 3 months because of direct mail they received. 93% of people ages, get this, 25 to 34. I think those are the, you know, they start with an M. The millennials respond to direct mail, believe it or not. I don't know. I have a granddaughter who's going to be 14, and she's all old school. She loves anything old school, like mail and like records and like thrift store clothes. Anyway, they're sick of screens. They like getting direct mail. 88% respond within 6 months. Interesting. Not everybody buys something the second they learn about it. Again, it depends on the type of product it is or the type of service, how expensive it is, if it's a spontaneous decision or if it's something they super need that's going to solve a problem or if it's a luxury item. So it's the timing is all very different. That's just an average. So now, I'm sorry if I'm going too fast, but we have so much to cover. If I'm going too fast, type it, I guess, in the questions thing. And then that way, I'll slow down, but let me know, or Jessica can let me know. Okay, we're gonna talk about mailing lists, all right? Oops, let me see, here we go. You don't wanna be all things to all people. I know, like one time I had this girl, a friend of mine, my neighbor, come to see me about her practice. She's a chiropractor. And I said, what is the main thing that you help people with their bodies? And she goes, I help them with everything. I can help them lose weight. I can help them detox. I can help them with their back pain. I can help them with headaches. I can help people with diabetes. I went, whoa, 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 whoa. Pick something. What is the most thing, the thing that most people come in for help with? And she's like, I don't know. And she couldn't answer the damn question. And the reason I'm asking her the question is because you don't want to be all things to all people, because then you're nothing to anyone, believe it or not, when it comes to marketing. So you want to pick one thing, and you want to pick one demographic that one thing that you sell would appeal to, right? So it's really important to figure out who exactly you want to target. And there are many, many different types of mailing lists, so I'll go over a few of those. There's a consumer list. Those are people, individuals, and you can get all kinds of great information. You can target woman in the household, children under the age of 12, or even children by age. You can, you know, home value, whether they rent or own, household income. I mean, just, you can just, so many different things that you can, and of course, by zip code and really, really target. You can also just target an area if you want to. You can just say, I want to hit everybody. You know, if you're a fast food restaurant or even any kind of a restaurant, you want to hit like certain zip codes where everybody might be your target market. And that's less expensive, but consumer lists are not pricey at all. The next thing you see there, it says SIC list. That stands for Standard Industrial Classification or Code. And it's basically a number that classifies an industry, and it's usually four digits, and then there's like another four digits. Like if it's manufacturing, it would be like certain four digits, and then if they manufacture pipes, it's different, another four digits after that. An opt-in list is, I don't buy any opt-in lists. So you know, if you get emails from people, from businesses that you never heard of, you're on some opt-in list. I don't believe you actually think or know you opted in. So I wouldn't recommend those kinds of lists, and they're silly. Subscriber lists can be very, very good. For instance, we once had a client that sold, I think they're called tree chairs. It's for hunting. And they would mail to some hunting magazine's subscriber list because they were, you know, selling these tree stools or tree chairs. I forget what they were called. Anyway, but the problem with subscriber lists is they're pricey, and they ordinarily only allow you to mail one time to the list. And I'll tell you right now, you don't want to mail to any list one time because it's pointless. You'll get maybe a little bit of business, but that is not going to change your business, not going to change your bottom line, your top line at all. You want to get, when you order a list, you want to get unlimited usage. And you're really only getting unlimited usage for 1 year. And don't buy or rent the list for one-time usage and then use it unlimited. You're not paying for what you get. You're paying for something and you're doing something you're not supposed to. But aside from the personal integrity on that, they seed the list. The list compiler will seed the list. That means they put their address in there and they'll know if you use a list more than once, and they'll come after you for the payment for the unlimited. It's not that much more, but always, always, always get unlimited usage on a list. So there are a lot of shysters out there when it comes to mailing lists. So I want to arm you with some questions to ask before you rent a mailing list. And that is basically this. These are the questions right here. You don't need to write these down, but if you email me at joy.genduza, G-E-N-D-U-S-A at postcardmania.com, I'll send you a PDF of this slideshow. But these are the questions like, how often is the list provider's database updated? Do you know what the answer to that question should be? How often is the list provider's database updated? The answer should be continuously. It's constantly being updated because people move every single minute of every single day. So there's got to be, this list has to constantly be being updated. You also want to ask if deliverability is guaranteed. Well, since people are moving all the time, basically if they say, yes, we have a 90% deliverability guarantee, that is good. So you'll take 90%. We guarantee 90%, but I don't think anybody ever gets back more than 5%. So I think our deliverability is really, really good. But these are like, if you're not buying from us, you want to make sure you're asking these questions. You want to know if they'll refund postage on any bad addresses over that 90%. So let's say, what if I get, 15% returns? Will you give me back the postage? Because the postage is the lion's share of your direct mail campaign. So you want to make sure they're willing to take real responsibility for the names that they're selling you or renting you, I should say. And there, can I reuse the list? Make sure you get a whole thumbs up on that because you have to be able to reuse that list. Okay, I'm going to talk to you about design now. There's a lot to understand in design. Over the 20 years, I've really honestly have gotten down what are the most successful actions in direct mail design. And I'm going to start with designing your ad with the person who's receiving it or looking at it in mind rather than your colleagues or yourself. Because what I've seen a lot of people do is use terminology that's industry terminology that a lay person who's receiving the card has never heard of before. And I might have some examples in here that I'll show you, but the reason I show you these nice, lovely women with this thing called wrinkle cream is because I have a little story There's a company called Aminogenesis. It's a client of ours. And many, 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 many moons ago, many years ago, apparently I had looked at his website and given him a critique. And basically I went to the website and it was around Halloween time. And it was like this black background website. He sells skincare. And it's this black background website. And there's like these pictures of these like Halloween ghouls on the website, because he had like a Halloween special, like vampires and ghouls. And then I'm like, this is terrible. So I just sent it. I did a really, really simple critique. I said, just make a white background, get a woman with beautiful, beautiful skin, have her kind of looking up with her hand on her face, and have like, you know, pink and mostly white and maybe some gray copy. And, you know, anyway, he did what I said. And then that was the end of that. But I didn't know he did what I said. I didn't, you know, I never followed up with him. It was just, he asked me to look. I did. I sent him the data. Maybe he thanked me. I don't remember. But then in 2010, I was out in California. And in 2010, we started to get video case studies. We have a ton of video case studies on our website. And he was out in California. And then my team told me, go do a video case study. I did about, I don't know, about 15 or 20 of them myself with a videographer in the beginning, just to see what kind of questions I wanted to ask. And I was in California, so I drove out. He was in Orange County. I drove out to see him. And when I met him, I didn't remember that he, I didn't know, I didn't put it together that that was the guy that I did the critique of. So when I met him, he was like, oh my God, I have to thank you. I really have to thank you. You helped me so much. When you critiqued my website, my sales in the next 6 months increased by $200,000. And I did nothing else. I didn't do any extra mail. I didn't do any extra driving people to the site, just the normal stuff. Thank you so much. And the problem, of course, was that his site didn't appeal to women who were his main target audience. So you want to make your marketing really appeal to the audience that you're sending it to. Okay, now we'll get to designing a postcard that works, or really any marketing piece. This is kind of I'm not going into the whole design thing in this particular PowerPoint, because on this webinar, because I did a webinar, I think it was last week, and I went into detail on design. And I think that one is recorded and it might be coming in a newsletter. They don't tell me the details, but you can get it. You can see last week's, but I'll show you again what I had gone over. And these were basically the 12 ingredients that should be on a direct mail piece, but I'm not going to stay here. I'm going to show you a couple of case studies of direct mail, and then we'll get into some other things. Okay. I just want to leave this up here for one more second for you to just be able to read it all. And then you should see last week's webinar. All right. So this is Borealis Dental Studio, and they mailed to a list of 24,000 people within a 10-mile radius of their practice, and they started doing 6,000 postcards per month, which is a good amount for dentists, and they usually wind up going to 12,000 a month, as they did. And they mailed for 12 months straight, and I think they were new practice, and they did 228,000 in revenue, which was an 143% increase in the monthly new patients. They spent every month about $3,700. And they had almost a 1,000% ROI, return on investment. This is a pool maintenance case study, Symbiont Service. Their own list, they were 18,000 commercial prospects for pool care. They mailed 1,000 cards per week for 12 months. And they did about $350,000 in business. And that cost them $24,800. I don't know why that cost seems off to me, because it's whatever, but they wound up making $353,000. So it was a 1,400% return on investment. But you know, direct mail is really just one channel, right? There's also Google and there's social media, and those are kind of like the big three right now that are really going to get you the best results. Let me just talk a little bit with you about what's happening today with marketing, different than when I first started my business. So 88.5% of Americans use the internet. And I'm telling you, the other 14.5%, they're probably babies, right? I mean, I think even little kids use the internet. It's crazy. 68% of American adults use Facebook. 68% of American adults. Do you know who's not using Facebook? It's probably teenagers. I think they're probably more on Snapchat and Instagram, I don't know. But I can tell you that my dad, who's 88 years old, is a Facebook user. 60% of searches happen on mobile devices. Not when you're doing B2B, that's really more for B2C, business to consumer, as opposed to business, because I know most of our traffic, we're business to business, are on desktop computers. So you really have to figure out how to take advantage of multi-channel marketing, how to stay in front of your prospects and customers wherever they are. Okay, if they're on Facebook, if they're just surfing the internet, they have mailboxes, how do you stay in front of them everywhere they spend their time? So I'm going to go over with you how to do this multi-channel promotion. Okay, now we'll start with Google. Just want to give you some stats. 75% of searchers, the people doing the searching, never scroll past page one of the results. I'm really a page one girl. I mean, once in a while I go to page two if I'm really hunting something down that I can't find, you know, but not usually for products. Usually when it's products, I'm a page one girl, but 25% people do go past, okay? 66% of new customers use search and online research to find local businesses. So if you have a local business, people are using the internet and search to find you that way, okay? Let me give you some stats on Google Ads, all right? The Google Display Network, that's when you see, when you're on some website, like some news website or any website that is showing banner ads or for other businesses. That's what the Google Display Network, there's like millions of sites in the Google Display Network, and Google allows you to place ads on these sites, and they charge for it either by the click. Anyway, Google, that display network reaches 90% of internet users worldwide, and 65% of whom they reach every single solitary day. Now, if you show, now listen to this carefully. This next thing I'm going to say is very important. Listen carefully. If you show ads on Google and Facebook to people who have already visited your website, you will increase response by 400%. This is very important. So we are going to talk a little bit about promoting using also social media, okay? So the amount of people that are using social media, I told you my dad is on Facebook. He's the cutest thing ever. Of course, every comment he makes on Facebook is in all caps. Why do old people do that? Anyway, he's still pretty adorable. But it's a huge number of people. 128 million people in the U.S. use Facebook every single solitary day. 63% of people, 50 to 64, I'm in that age group, are on Facebook. I'm on Facebook. I like Facebook. 56% of those 65 and older are on Facebook. 79% of Facebook's daily users access the site via their cell phone, okay? Now, if you're using it for lead generation, you're not going to have a super easy time of it. Unless you have an e-commerce store and you have some great, amazing new product, and I've bought lots of things, you know, clicking through ads. I got some great eyebrow stuff from China. I love it. Saw it in my Facebook feed when I need that, bought it. But most small business owners are more service-oriented products, you know, in the home improvement field, in landscaping, or in the medical arts. And people are not, you know, they're not going to see a Facebook ad and become your client necessarily. But it is really, I mean, the stat on it is only 4% of social media leads become customers. But it is an amazing, amazing, amazing follow-up tool, because I am sure that you have heard more than once that repetition is king, that the number of times a person sees your ad, that makes you more and more real to them, and the more they see your ad, the better. And social media is an amazing, amazing follow-up tool. So if I just go backwards a little bit, back to this slide, showing Google and Facebook ads to prospects who have already visited your website can increase response by 400%. So let's go back to where we were. We'll talk a little bit about Facebook, okay? I'm going to just tell you some things about Facebook that you may or may not know, but just bear with me here. All right, this is the problem. So this is a photo of little Wes Kaczynski, this little baby. And the lady holding him is a cashier at our local natural health food store called Nature's Food Patch here in Clearwater. Now this, if you look here, this person, Sarah Payson Kaczynski, she is, what happened? It moved and I didn't want it to. Hang on. All right. She posted this picture of her son. Now she's not a Facebook user. She's really an Instagram girl. Okay. So she had about 49 people liked this picture. They saw it in her feed, her friends. That's called organic user reach. She didn't pay. She's posted it on her wall and she had 49 people like it. One person shared it. Who shared it? I'll tell you who shared it. Nature's Food Patch shared it because it was adorable. And Nature's Food Patch has like thousands of likes on their page. They have thousands of people that like their page. It's a business page, but only 20 people liked it. Why? Not because it's not adorable, but because this is the story. Facebook cares about their business more than your business. Okay. So when Facebook became a publicly traded company, they had to change the way things were. They had to get people paying to have any business. They have to get the people paying to have their posts seen. So this line that you see going down this way, that's average organic page reach for businesses. And this blue, that's the Facebook stock price. Okay. Does that make sense? And Facebook has some pitfalls. They have a beautiful graphic user interface. They make it very easy to do sponsored ads, to pay for your ads. But there are pitfalls, like targeting too broadly will waste a lot of money, or only boosting posts instead of running actual ads and testing ads, and really not tracking very, very precisely exactly which factors are causing views to become leads, people to click through. Now, just like any marketing at all, any marketing you're doing at all, including Facebook, it all boils down to this. You want to drive that traffic to a page in your website. We call it a landing page because it's the page that they would land on, that continues the message that the Facebook ad started and has the ability to capture the identity of the person. We want to give them a reason to fill out a form. Get a cash offer for your house and they're asking for your email address. So the idea is that any marketing you're doing, you're driving the person from that ad to a specific page that continues the communication and also attempts to get them to fill out a form. Generally, for that form fill out, you have to have something of really high value that doesn't cost you very much, that the person really wants enough to give their email address. Only ask for an email address. You can get more data from them later. You can get a pop-up that says, hey, we'd like more information from you. Please give us your home address and your phone number. And maybe they won't, but at least you now have an email address. People don't want to give out their info. So if you ask only for an email address, it's not a very big commitment. And the person would be like, I think I can handle that. I'll give you my email address and then I'll unsubscribe. But in the meantime, you've got their email address. And if you send them a good email with real communication, then you may actually turn them into a really, really good lead. So again, making sure you have an ad that looks like the page they're being sent to and continues that communication. Just here's just some examples, good examples. Of a good ad that goes to a page that can capture the idea. I think this was actually, you can't see the whole thing, but this is they can just buy it right from there. These are just some examples for you. This is a bad example. And the reason why is because you got all that yellow going on and I didn't even know that I arrived at the right place. So what I was explaining is the key to these paid ads is not necessarily a purchase, but more of generating a lead. So you can see here, what I'm showing you here is you see a postcard. Person gets the postcard. They're interested. They go to the website. You know, 96% of the people that go to your website that are interested leave without doing a damn thing. They leave without doing anything. Okay? So if you're not following up with them on Facebook and Google, you spent that money to get that person to go to your website. And how are we going to remind them to go back to that website? That's the 400% increase in response. Because what happens is when the person gets the postcard and they're super interested and they go to the website and they leave without filling out the form and without doing anything, now they're going to see these Google ads and Facebook ads everywhere they go so that they'll click back. Okay? Following me? So let me just show you how it all works together. I just want to show you how this works together. And I'm just showing you this slide a third time because it's such an important thing that I want you to understand, that showing Google and Facebook ads to prospects who have already visited your website can increase response by 500%. And I'm not making up the repetition thing here. There are lots of experts in marketing. One of the essences of PR and promotion is that we have to pound the same message home time and time again. That's Oren Hubbard from Policy Letter Repetition of Message. We have a single ad, no matter how compelling, is almost never enough to sell your product. That's Seth Godin. If you don't believe in your product, or if you're not consistent and regular in the way you promote it, the odds of succeeding go way down. Jay Levinson, you know, the guy from Guerrilla Marketing. I want to show you some ads and some click-through rates, okay? So just to show you repetition and how important it is, because it really cannot be overstated. So these are just Google ads that are, you know, from a postcard that looked similar, but these are the Google ads. So this Google ad was shown 67,418 times. And out of all those times it was shown, there were 259 clicks back to the website, okay? This on the middle one, 380, almost 385,000 impressions with 364 clicks. The last one, 78, almost 79,000 impressions, 290 clicks. And that brings me to Everywhere Small Business. And what we've decided to do, since we know all of this, is to create a product / a service that does this for the small business owner, that does this for you. All the marketing that I do for myself, for my company, for my 180,000 postcards that I mail, I do Everywhere Small Business, and I would not do direct mail without incorporating this product with it. Let me explain to you exactly how it works. It's four components that we're adding to a traditional direct mail piece. We're adding mail tracking. I'm going to go over all of these individual with you. Mail tracking, call tracking, the Google ads, and Facebook and Instagram. So let's talk about mail tracking first. You've seen this barcode on mail pieces before. Basically, we've taken that and we've decoded it, if you will, and you can log into a dashboard and see the predicted delivery date of your mail piece, and you can see the confirmed delivery date of your mail piece. And I'll show you what that looks like in the dashboard. It just looks like this. You log in, and you can see it right there. You can see the delivery date was, you know, April 18th, and 14,978 pieces were delivered that day. That's actually showing you the predicted delivery date, not the actual. This is the actual delivery date. 99.6% of the pieces were delivered. There was a portion that were undeliverable, or they didn't go through the scanner at the post office very well. The next thing, of course, is call tracking. Now, I would never want an answering service to pick up my phone because I'm very, very picky about the first impression of my company, and I always want my own people to pick up the phone. So we put you can have a regional phone number, a national phone number, or a local phone number on your piece, and it rings in your business. But it actually, before it rings in your business, it gets picked up in the cloud and it gets recorded. But it is ringing in your business, okay? Now, what happens is you can go into the dashboard and you can see how many total callers there are. You can see here the total number of callers, and then you can see the unique callers, because people are going to call you on that phone number, and then next time they call in, they'll call on that phone number as well. So that's really cool. And you can listen. You can listen to the calls right in there and hear what they sound like so that you can quality control your front desk people or your sales people. It's fantastic. The next thing about Everywhere Small Business is the online follow-up. First, we'll talk about Facebook and Instagram. First thing we do is we take your mailing list and we upload it to Facebook and we find as many matches as we can. When it's business to consumer, we can find between 60 and 90% of the people, and we can hit them with ads before they even receive your postcard in the mail. So let's show you what that looks like. So on day, let's say we put the postcards in the mail, but they're not there yet. They take at least 3 days to get there. So on days 1, 2, and 3, as your postcards are being mailed, your prospects are going to see your Facebook ads. They're going to be like, okay, whatever. And they're going to see you in their Instagram feed. Okay, whatever. Then, bada bing, they get a postcard in the mail and they're like, wow, this looks familiar. Now it's not just like a random postcard. It actually looks familiar to them. And they receive it in the mail and they go, you know, I want to get some cash out of my house. And they go to your website. But of course, 96% of them are going to leave without taking any action. They're not going to call you. They're not going to fill out your form. So when they leave, they're going to start seeing your ads literally every day, all over the internet. Literally for 3 months, they're going to see your ads, okay, from mail date. 3 months from mail date, they're going to see them in their Facebook feeds, on Google. This was on Google, see? And this is on Facebook, and this is now on Instagram. And what happens is when they click on that ad, they can go back to your site because now they're like, I was interested. I was interested enough to go to their website the first time, but I wasn't ready to make a decision. But now with this repetition of message, they're more ready to make a decision. So that's how it works. So there's direct mail, there's the Google ads, the Facebook ads, and the Instagram ads. And how it works is this, just to show you how it works. When you sign up for it, we give you this little bit of code and you put it on, we give you two codes. We give you a code for Facebook. Facebook calls it a pixel. And Google calls it a cookie. Silly words. And you put them on your website, and then every time someone goes to your website, they get cookied or pixeled, and then you can follow them around the internet, okay? So when they go to the millions of sites on Google, they go to Facebook, they're gonna see your ad. Now, basically, when they leave your website, they start seeing your ads everywhere. And let's look at some more click-through rates. Here is a mortgage company. They got 16,000 impressions and 49 clicks. Their newer customer, this company, 818,000 impressions, over 3,000 clicks, 116,000 impressions, 519 clicks, 14,400 impressions and 49 clicks. So you can see the amount of impressions it takes to get them to click, right? I mean, look at yourself as a consumer. Do you buy the instant you see something the first time? No. I mean, why are all the large companies, why are they household names? Why is Coca-Cola a household name? Nike? Because they market like crazy to you with their brand. Here are some case studies that use, I guess, Everywhere Small Business, or this is, some of them are just direct mail 2.0 if they only have a Google banner ad. They gave us a mailing list. They mailed 6,000 pieces 4 times. They wrote 60 new policies. I know this guy. There's a video case study with this guy on our website, and the whole campaign only cost him $11,000. He made a lot of money off of that. It was great. I already showed you this one, so let's see what the next one is. Atlanta Home Designers. You can see their Google banner ad. They purchased 2,500 records of homeowners ages 40 to 65 with a household income of $100,000 with a home value of 200,000 plus built between these specific years, 1985 to 2005. And they're doing home renos, right? So they really want a specific, this is what I mean. You can get so specific on your mailing list. They mailed 2,500 monthly for 6 months and they got 29 calls and 348 clicks on their banner ad. And they made $80,000. So that was good. Here's one for a little school, Dobson Academy. They purchased only 2,000 records, homes with children 5 to 11, and a household income of $35,000 to $150,000. They mailed 2,000 cards 3 times. So they hit the same list 3 times. They enrolled 7 students right away. They spent $3,300 and they made $35,000 off of those 7 students. So that was pretty awesome. I already showed you Patuxent Dental. I don't need to show you again. Oh my goodness, you know what? That brings us to the end. I have something for you. I have something for you, especially if you stayed on the call. You get a special prize. We have an offer for webinar attendees. You can get, if you order Everywhere Small Business, we will give you 5,000, up to 5,000 free postcards when you order Everywhere Small Business. And apparently, according to this slide, the offer is only valid for 14 days. Now, this phone number is a call tracking phone number because I want to see how many people from this webinar are interested enough to call in and speak to one of my marketing consultants. Here's the deal. If you call in and talk to one of my marketing consultants, please allow them to do their job. They are so well trained and they will ask you, allow them to ask you every question under the sun, moon, and stars about your business because they know what works and they have to get data out of you to be able to advise you on the best campaign for your business. They know so much. So please allow them to ask you a million questions. Call 855-514-2389 and please take advantage of this special offer. Now, I am also going to give you, I'll go back to this slide so you can have the phone number, but we're going to do questions and answers. And if you want this slide presentation, you can email me at joy.genduza@postcardmania.com and I'm happy to give it to you. But write down this phone number that's on this slide. And Jessica, does anybody have any questions?
Hey, Joy. Yeah, actually, we have a question that Florence asked back when you were going over mailing lists. And she wants to know, do you recommend EDDM lists and why/what are the issues?
Okay, so EDDM, all that means stands for everybody else is everywhere direct mail, everywhere, every door direct mail, EDDM, right? Every door direct mail, yes. I'm sorry, I was going a little bit blank with my ESB, with my everywhere small business, every door direct mail. And you are basically targeting an entire area. It's not really, you don't get to put the name of the person necessarily on the piece. It's like resident. And it's a lot cheaper postage for you. You save on the postage. So if you're in an industry that doesn't require specific demographics, then it's fine. If you're a restaurant, it's totally fine. A lot of times it's fine for dentists. What industry are you in? I'm asking her. Does she say?
She hasn't answered yet. She's a realtor.
Okay. So yeah, you can do, if you're farming a particular area, then you definitely can do EDDM, no problem, because you want to hit every home in a particular area. But the pitfalls, you know, sometimes it's like you have to also hit this area. Like I live in a zip code 33756. Yeah, duh. And where I live, it's like the homes are pretty high-end homes. And then like across the street, it's the same zip code and it's completely not. So it depends. You know, sometimes you want to target home value too. It's up to you and homeowner. So it's really talk to one of my marketing consultants and they'll walk you through what's the best for you.
A couple of people asked for you to put up your other side with your email address so they can get the presentation.
Okie dokie. I will do it. There it is.
And then
it's so easy. It's joy.genduza, my name.
Okay, Carol's wondering, can she get the webinar special if we're already an ESB customer?
I have no idea how it works. She has to call in and ask. They'll do something for you for sure. If you call in and be like, hey, I was just on the webinar and I want an extra 5,000 cards, talk to them. They'll figure out something for you, I promise. But I don't know I don't know the ins and outs. I don't make up the prices anymore, you guys. I don't know what the prices are anymore. We've got 227 staff now and I'm basically, what do? I don't know. I buy Christmas presents for everybody. That's what I do. I do webinars when Jessica makes me. But I do enjoy it. Okay.
Renee is wondering, do you have staff that specialize in a specific industry? In my case, it's commercial janitorial services.
You know, we do have some. Like, if you've never spoken to anyone, they'll find you someone who has done that industry. But I know personally that we have done that industry, and we have somebody here that's called a results manager. And what she does is catalogs the results of all the different campaigns that we've done. And her name is Dawn. And whoever you talk to can access that catalog and find the results of those campaigns.
Great. Let's see.
But I know we have commercial janitorial is not a large enough industry to have one person specializing in it for us, but I know we have people that specialize in dental. We have people that specialize in insurance, like some of the industries that we do a lot of, but we have done lots of commercial janitorial. So you're good.
Okay. Phil is wondering, okay, let me just go back. He says, I'm coming to the September seminar. Will these free webinars be available then? I'm trying to organize a marketing plan and don't really know what I am doing. Can't wait to take advantage of the offer.
Yeah, we'll take good care of you. You could come to anybody, you know, this, if you want to go check it out, anybody who's listening, it's postcardmania.com/growth summit. You have to be a customer to, no, I think you can, if you're a customer, it's $197 a ticket. And if you're not a customer, it's like $9.95 or something crazy. But, we'll take care of you. We will help you. It's a lot to learn, and I don't want you to feel, I'm so happy that you're on the call and that you came to the webinar, because it is a lot to confront and a lot to learn, but we will help you and make sure that, you know, I want you to understand, because I don't want anybody just like throwing their money at something. They have no idea what they're doing, and then they're all don't know what's happening, but we'll explain it to you as best we can. And you'll learn so much at the Growth Summit. Growth Summit is literally like 2 days of hardcore. It's like a boot camp. It's like hardcore.
Can you explain kind of more details about it? There's a few questions coming in about where and when and how do they learn more.
Okay, so what I do is I have an amazing speaker who does the first 3 hours of Growth Summit, and he talks about sales, and he is absolutely unbelievably amazing. He'll be the best speaker you've ever heard ever. And then I have to follow him, which kind of is tough for me. But I do the next day and a half, and you learn about so many aspects of marketing, but each thing I go over, I go slow, and I give you practical assignments that you do right at your table during the summit. So you're actually getting your hands dirty, and you're having to think, and you're having to write copy and figure out design that you want to. It is a brain squeezer. It's like I make you work, but my people walk around and help you too, so that you're not just like, I don't know what to do. Like, we help you, and I want you to, my whole goal for that event is to put you in the driver's seat of your marketing, to really understand, you know, how much marketing it really takes to get where you want to go. I've got a gal who sent her marketing guy twice to the event. He would go home and try to get her to do what he learned, and she would never do it. And eventually he convinced her to come to the event. So she came to the event, and at the end of the event, she came up to me and she said, oh my goodness, Joy, I am going to do whatever you tell me to do, I am going to do. And I laid out an entire program that I wanted her to do, and she implemented it, and she has boomed her business. She was already doing $9 million a year. She's doing, I think she tripled in size. She sells art to corporations. It's like very unusual business, but it's niche also. And she has very specific areas that she does. And then I had somebody else, I want to tell you something, like, not to brag, like, I'm not doing this to be a bragger, but if a person does what we tell them to do, they will do well. And you have to understand, marketing is not an exact science. But if you do the consistency, we will continue to tweak the design, tweak the list, change things up on your Google ads and your Facebook ads until we get the perfect formula. But that quantity, nothing trumps that quantity.
Well said, well said. Here, here. Let's see. We have two more questions. I know it's a little past 3, but we'll get to them really quickly.
I think we have a 3:00, so we got to go.
Okay, never mind. I'll email them.
We can do it. They can wait. There's a couple more. Okay. I'll do one more.
Okay, you're so generous. Okay, so Hal is wondering, I have clients that are in the dental field. How should I present your program to them so I can keep control? Many of my professional medical clients are so much into micromanaging.
I feel you. I'm not sure who, if you already have a person that you're assigned to, but I can have a conversation with you. We normally have, we have one area of our organization that works with people who have clients and want to resell our product or handle the client. And that's, I don't know if you're working with Saskia or Sammy or Kristen. Do you know? Does he know? Saskia is my VP corporate relations, corporate sales. And she would be the person to help you with that more than me, but I can help you. It's a trick.
He's working with Kristen. So
he's working with Kristen. So you're already with my corporate girls. Yeah. So they want to micromanage. I think it has a lot to do with how you present it to them and how much confidence you have in your presentation. I don't know. That's a good question, because we do have some docs that want to micromanage, but then I had a guy, I was literally like really trying to get him to come to Growth Summit. And he goes, I don't want to learn it. I just want to be a dentist. So it's the personalities. You know, I would say that when I would handle any client that wants, I don't handle clients anymore, but of course I did back in the day. I would just be so bloody confident in what I was telling them and tell them, you do what you do, you know, give them analogies. Do you want the patient to tell you if they need a root canal or not? Do you want the patient to tell you whether they need deep scaling? I mean, come on, you know, it's like, you know what you know, and I know what I know. I would just be like a very cocky, you know, person.
Okay, so the last question, and we've got it from Anthony. He's got two different things, so I'm going to try to piece them together. So he sells recovering government hiring incentives from FESDA and states, and he's wondering if he can combine.
I don't know what that is. What the heck is that? What does he do? Recovering
what? He sells some government hiring incentives to. Okay. Other businesses, it sounds
okay.
like, if they hire
okay,
certain people, I guess. Yeah.
Okay.
And he wants to know if he can combine multiple lists from different SIC codes and different industries, and if he can and should do that.
No.
Okay.
He should do small, if it's only small mailings and very niche, he should do digital. We can do smaller quantities, put them all together, make different designs for each one, have each one communicate specifically to that SIC code. Otherwise, it's going to be all things to all people. We don't want to do that. That was lesson number one.
So true. Okay. And thank you, Joy. That wraps it up. I think we got to let you take your 3 o'clock. Thank you so much for taking the time to share your wisdom.
I'm so happy to do it. You have me doing another one next week, don't you?
Yes. Yes. And everybody take a look. I know Joy talked earlier about lead capture and what goes into that, and that's really what we're going to drill into in the webinar August 1st. And everybody, you're going to get a link to register for that tomorrow in Joy's newsletter.
I didn't even know that that's what it was about. I'm really happy that that's what it's about. That's a big one.
Yeah. I can read your mind.
Okay, cool. All right, you guys. Thank you very much for attending. I appreciate it. Bye.
Bye.